Sri Jayalakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the Hindu Academy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri Lakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
When we pray to God, how do we know that God can see us praying to Him?
Okay. You see, suppose you are very devout. Let me be very honest. Suppose you're very devout. You like to think of spirituality, religion in a personalized manner. Nothing wrong, eh? It's a nice way of thinking about spirituality. Focusing on one personality. So when you look at the image of Shiva, I love Shiva. I just love him. I don't know why. I love him. If you are actually fixated like that and you love God as a personality, look, I'm not saying it's wrong. This is the way you become spiritual. So you use the idea of God as a personality, and then how do you know he's listening? Because you make him listen. You are the creator of that personality, and that creator, that personality will listen to you. Suppose I'm really, really, you know, very keen on thinking of God as Shiva, then I'm telling you, when I pray to Shiva, he will listen, because I'll make him listen. He's my creation, I make him listen. There's a nice story in the Puran, you see the colorful storytelling. A story about, you know, this guy called Dhruva, who wanted to see God as Vishnu. It's a colorful story, but a very powerful philosophic idea in it. So, poor little Dhruva, little chap, kept repeating the name of Om Namo Narayan, and finally Vishnu appeared, said, no, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudeva, he kept repeating. And then Vishnu appeared. My boy, I'm here. And Dhruva looked at, ah, so wonderful. Then he looked at Vishnu's form, you know, forearms and all that. And then Dhruva asked one very pointed question. He said, Vishnu, why is your kundal, you know, this ear piece is not kind of tinkling? Why are they kind of steady? They're not moving. And Vishnu answered, my boy, you created me like this, you make them move. You make them move. This is the story of Dhruva. It shows the philosophic idea. We generate an image of God and he becomes that for us. He's such a lovely chap. This thing called Brahman takes on the form of your desire. I want to see God as my mommy, my mother goddess. And God becomes a mother goddess and stands in front of you and plays with you and talks to you and dances with you. This is reality of Hindu tradition. It is true. So if you're fixated on the idea of thinking God is a personality, this grand thing called Brahman will take that form and come in front of you and interact with you in a dynamic way. Wow! So you don't just make believe. You actually can experience God as a personality if you want that to happen.
When smithies are produced, they only come with a disclaimer about the Shruti or philosophical ideas.
All the smithies, it's a very good question. The smritis actually, when you look at the smriti, read the smritis, they come with the health warning right at the start. This must take into account the desh and kar, the time and the place you live in. And it is not fixated. You mustn't be fixated on the smritis. The smritis come with a health warning. They're not just, I'm making it up now. All the smritis say, these are books suited to our time and this place. Not necessary forever. So the stuff that was suitable in India 1,000 years ago is definitely not necessarily suitable for the world that we live in the United Kingdom 1,000 years after. But who decides? You decide. Why should I decide? You think for yourself. Are they still relevant? Are the ideas of Smriti still relevant? Like I just told you, the mythology of ancient times, suppose I do the stories of all these lovely colorful gods and goddesses. You know, they may have suited the mind of ancient Hindus, but today these youngsters here, they prefer Harry Potter. How can I stop it? See, it is necessary for the smritis to evolve with the times. They're like this technological fighting rather than this antiquated fighting of bows and arrows. So be it. So this is, if you like, the codes of conduct you use in your family or your society must also change, must take into account the evolution in humanity, and so should the colorful storytelling.
How are the Abrahamic faiths different from the Indic faiths?
Yes. The Abrahamic faiths are fixated on God in heaven, all three of them, Judaism, Christianity, Islam. The religion cannot exist unless there is a God. They are fixated on a super personality. You may think that's all right, you know, that's the way many Hindus like to think God is Vishnu, Shiva, nothing wrong. But the problem is this, we live in modern times, which is very science-oriented, rational world. Now here the problem arises. This is how the problem arises. They are in trouble. All Abrahamic tradition are in trouble. Why? The moment you say God is almighty, all-knowing and all-compassionate, three qualities, all religions will give, all the Abraham will say, God is almighty, all-knowing, all-compassionate. Oh, wonderful. Then Richard Dawkins will come and say, come here, look around. See the living kingdom, animals, insects, they are each killing and biting each other while they're alive. Haven't you seen the Discovery Channel? They kill each other while they're alive. They're munching each other while they're alive. Insects, animals, not 100, not million, not billion, trillions. So Richard Dawkins says, if you say God created this, he's a nasty chap. Why should you worship him? That is why they become, they don't say, we are not sure about God, they say, we are sure there is no God. They are called atheists. Do you blame them? So the idea of God as a super personality is in serious trouble in this century. It won't survive this century. That's why, you see, the churches are being abandoned. No youngsters, go to any church, no youngster will be there. They can't relate to a God anymore. In fact, the only way to relate to God is to make fun of him. You know, take the mickey out of God. Look at all the TV programs. In the name of religion, they take the mickey out of it because they think it's nonsense, can't be real. So monotheism is in real trouble. The idea of a super personality, oh, I'm creator, is in trouble because of all the suffering all around. You can't run away from it. You can give excuses, but there's a cop-out. So the thinking youngsters say, rather not believe this. That is why the Abrahamic traditions are stuck in a rut because of monotheism linked to a God. What about the Indic tradition? We come in two flavors, I warned you. And the flavor that is kind of philosophically acceptable, the Shruti scripture, has no difficulty. There is no God there. Just talking of spirit manifesting, appearing in this creation. So there's no God, nobody to catch. You say, when this thing comes, becomes visible as living things, it's got a habit of biting itself and killing each other. It's not a God to blame. That is why it's safe, philosophically safe, because it's a principle-oriented religion, not a personality-oriented religion. That is why it's not even called a religion. Religion means aligning whole of humanity to God. We don't say, no, we say dharma. What the heck is all this? That's all you're making sense of, not looking for a God. That is why it's safe. Even when I talk like this at Eton or wherever top colleges, I don't get challenged. They fall in love, it's a good idea. Because there's nobody to catch and say, okay, how can you believe nonsense like that? There's no nonsense. Looking deeper reality, what is all this about? Answer that. That's what we're all about. That's why we're very safe. Not only safe, that is why the BBC won't let me get through.
Why do people think of God as with a personality and characteristics that is exaggerated as humans?
You see, this idea of getting fixated on a super personality, it's like human, but superhuman. It's somehow, if you like, our problem. Why? Because we are human beings. And in order for us to get a handle on what are these people, the only way we can get a handle on this idea of something greater than just human is to make it superhuman. It is, if you like, a human trait. We can't help it, it's a human characteristics. So if I'm little compassionate, I say, let me think of somebody who's all compassionate, he's all loving everything and everybody, even the nasty people, he loves them. Let me exaggerate. So what happens that because we are human, the only way we can get a handle on this idea of religion is to think about a superhuman. This is why we create all these super personalities with so many arms and all that, so many heads and all that. We are exaggerating human features, human attributes, which are the good ones, not the bad ones, the good ones, to try and relate to the idea of who are we, what is all this about. So we exaggerate the things already here. Like, you know, search for knowledge, search for, you know, kind of thirsty for knowledge, or being compassionate, or being empowered. I don't like to be pushed about. That's a natural thing for every living thing. So we exaggerate all these things. Oh, Lord, you are all powerful, you are all knowing, you are all compassionate. So you see, if you like human feature, in order to first understand it, we say exaggerate. And this is how we produce the God, or all these colorful gods and goddesses. They are human aspirations. Like, suppose I want to be learned, then I think of God. God, not a person, like a God is a mother goddess, Saraswati. She'll give me all the knowledge, music, art, everything comes from Saraswati. So I look at these ideas and project it on Saraswati and think of God as Saraswati. It's a human way of understanding the idea of religion. Nothing wrong with it.
What do Hindus think about converting into different religions?
The Hindu religion is a pluralistic tradition, means belief in many ways to be spiritual. It doesn't have any difficulty. Suppose you meet a good Christian who is trying to follow the teachings of Christ and becoming spiritual and religious. It's good for you. Carry on. Be a good Christian. If there is, you meet a Buddhist who says, I don't believe in God at all. I just want to sort myself here. It's good for you. Carry on. We are not at all worried by other people thinking about religion and God or spirituality in their own way. We are a pluralistic tradition, meaning in plural ways, many ways to be spiritual. So we have no difficulty with people of other religion. And another interesting thing is, we never go out to convert other people and say, you become Hindus. We don't go to other people, other countries, and control them and rule them and say, now you become Hindus, that will hit you, or will penalize you, or will kill you, or will convert you. We don't do things like that. Thankfully, we don't. We are a pluralistic, very broad-minded religion. At the same time, we don't like other people to come and tell us, convert to us. Why should we convert? We already have a very broad way of understanding religion. So many different pathways we allow within our own religion. Why should we convert and give up this broad teaching that we have learned about Hinduism and join your religion, which is very narrow and very blinkered and very prescriptive? So you must do this or I go to hell. Why should we join that? So we don't convert, but we don't like to be converted either. So if somebody says, we will convert you, otherwise we'll kill you, we will fight you. We don't tolerate nonsense. So we do not believe in conversion. It goes against the teaching of pluralism. This is a very good question to explore, because in India they are struggling.
Religions have been created by one or a few people, but how is it possible that a vast number of people can believe that one person's idea?
Yes. Again, I don't know where this boy gets his ideas. It is true. When you think about religions are creation of humanity, we human beings create religions. So how can we be sure that this is for real and it really works? Why should we be sure? The answer is this. Until you experience something deeper about yourself and the world that we live in, until you actually, you, not me, not your prophet, not the people who set up religion, but you experience it for yourself, don't be sure about it. This is openness. Unless, suppose I talk about all these high things, unless I experience it, I cannot be sure. I must be humble and say, I don't know if people of religion, Hinduism say this is true. I can't be sure. I have not experienced it. So be open to yourself, and what will happen is, by being open, by just closing my eyes, he said in the Bhagavad Gita is enough. That's not enough. That's just an indicator. You have to experience this thing for yourself to truly subscribe to it. Otherwise, don't subscribe. My boy, don't subscribe. I'm like that. Always say, I'm not sure what's going on. But be open-minded, and then you are safe. But never kind of subscribe just because everybody, your forefathers said, do it, don't do it. Think for yourself.
If Sikh and Jainism and Buddhism, they all come from Hinduism, why are there three different paths?
Very good question. You see, the Indic religion is religion that sprang out of India. What are the four Indic religions? Hinduism, very ancient, very vast, and very comprehensive. Then we have got Buddhism. Then we have got Jainism, at the same time as Buddhism, I would say, and then Sikhism, latest one. These are called Indic religions. My religion came out of India. They have a lot of commonality, a lot of common features. For example, the idea of dharma, the word that we use for all of, the same for all the four religions, they use the word dharma. The Buddhists pronounce it dhamma, but same dharma. So we stick to the word dharma, making sense of the human condition. That's a central feature. The next thing that we share is the law of karma. All of us share the law of karma, all four of these traditions. The next thing we subscribe to is reincarnation. All these four, yes, reincarnation. Buddhists use different word, but reincarnation. So we share that. But then why are they different? This young boy is asking you a lovely question. Why do you have four so many different ones? The answer is this. And always we are very broad-minded. So if the Buddhists say didn't come out of Hinduism, we are separate religion. Sikhism say came out of Hinduism, we are separate. We say fair enough. We don't fight over that. They came out because look, the founder of Buddhism, Buddha, was a Hindu prince. The founder of Sikhism was a Hindu. You see, so we say that, okay, you can say it's a different religion. We don't come to compromise and jump on you, say, okay, it's a different religion. But it has similar foundation. So all of, for example, Buddhism based on the idea of meditation, to sort yourself out. Again, a Hindu idea. Adopted and turned into a major religion, Buddhism. So there is a variation. The only way, how you can distinguish them is this. The Hindus have to subscribe to the idea of Vedas as a scripture of authority. You can't be Hindu unless you say the Upanishads, etc. I love. This is the heart of throbbing heart of Hinduism. Upanishads, remember, not the legendary stories. The philosophic parts of Atman and Brahman. We said this is the foundation. If you subscribe to it, you are a Hindu. Suppose you say, I don't want to accept the authority of the Vedas, then you can be non-Hindu. So you can be a Buddhist, a Jain or a Sikh because you don't subscribe to the Vedas. You say, we got our own scripture, the Guru Granth Sahib, whatever. We say, good for you. See, we are pluralistic. We don't feel worried by it, don't feel offended. Suppose somebody's come out from our religion, but produce a new major religion like Buddha, good for him. A lot of people like that, so be it. We don't get frightened by it. We like this variation. That's why we are a pluralistic tradition.
So even in other major religions, so there are many great leaders. So Moses, so there's many variations in his stories, but the name or the personality still remains the same. So, and even across Hinduism and Buddhism and quite a lot of common people, like the Buddha. So does this suggest that people actually lived, but then religions make them personalities, or personalities lived and then they made religions?
Ooh, what lovely philosophic question. Okay, just look. As we are pluralistic, we recognize, just as we give dynamic personality in Hinduism, the rishis, ancient and modern ones, we have dynamic personalities. Again and again, every century produces some huge, powerful personality. Like the one who is attracting me is called Vivekananda, who came about 100 years ago. Boom, dynamo. So we all continue to produce major personalities throughout the ages. And does it mean that other religions don't have it? No. Actually, I'm suggesting to you very honestly, we think that almost all the prophets of all the major world religions, including some of the mystics, you know, were kind of, you know, charged up. We feel all of them had spiritual experience. We don't say, oh, it's only for Hindus, only brown skin you can get experience. People in other parts of the world, during different parts of different times of history, would have the same, would have the spiritual experience. How does the variation come? This is what the boy is asking. Why variation? The variation comes in because once they have the experience, they want to try and explain this experience to the people they are living with. So they will use the method that is suited to the people they are interacting with. Suppose I'm born in the Middle East. Then the way I say, this is how you behave. Or I can say burning bush. So interpretation and the way they express their spiritual experience changes, not because they are trying to cheat us, but with this best suited to the way they think and the way the people they interact with think. So they're trying to produce an idea of spirituality suited to the people they are interacting with. Otherwise, they won't understand him. They'll throw stones at him and kill him. So they try and present the same idea suited to the people they are interacting. That's why you have variation. But we don't say only Indians and Hindus can get spiritual experience. People of other religions do. Thousands of them must have had spiritual experience. And we don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Why do people experience near-death experiences?
Okay. You see, a lot of people are fascinated by exotic things that we kind of come across, like the near-death experience, because we are not sure whether we're going to be reincarnated, is real or not. But near-death experience is something that happens around the clock. Thousands of that, I think 2,000 cases in Southampton University of near-death experience in the local hospitals. That's huge. So near-death experience is kind of quite common. So why does it happen? You see, we know that there's something more to us than the body. So when the body stops functioning, something seems to continue to exist. That is why it's exciting, because they thank God we are not just going to die. You don't get snuffed out when the body dies. Something is going to continue to survive. That is why it's kind of drawing a lot of attention. So near-death experience is, because even you can be a crass atheist, I don't believe in God and religion. I say, okay, but this near-death experience, everybody's, so many people are getting it. So what is going on there? So it's kind of become an exotic subject to explore. That is why people like it. And this is why, in every age, human beings become more evolved. They say that it's not just because, you know, kicked out of one body, maybe we can get back into the body. So this is becoming more kind of frequent now. So it's not because we are trying to do it. Human beings are evolving and are becoming conscious. They are more than the body, so they can go in and out of the body. That's why it's happening more often now.
You know, when you talked about the near-death experience, when the soul, it's kind of like when the person sees their dead relatives or they're pushing them back, we know that we can infer that the soul is halfway through the body, but they come back into the body. So there is a force of attraction. And what is it, and is it mentioned in the Vedas?
You see, the near-death experiences are not discussed in the Vedas. From what I've read of the Vedas, they're not there. But we have to use our common sense now and think exactly what is going on, because it's not something that's restricted to Hindus. People of other religion, no religion, get the same experience. So something very universal is happening, so we try and interpret it. The Vedas didn't talk about it. You know, they're kind of focused on, wow, I get the good experience. Wow, it's what they talk about. So this idea of leaving the body and coming back into the body, etc., is not discussed as far as I know in the Vedas. But there may be some bits and pieces somewhere, but I've not found any. The important thing is we as human beings, using our rational faculties, don't forget, never switch this off in the name of religion. You think for yourself, always use your rational faculty to make sense of the world we live in. So using our rational faculties, we try and understand this near-death experience, what it's like and what happens to us. So it's not something that's in the Vedas, but something that we actually have learned about in this day and age.
So how do we know if Mahabharata and Ramayana actually took place and is real when we don't really have evidence to prove these kind of stories?
Very good and very pointed question. How can we, look, we are saying Mahapurana Puran, storytelling, legendary stories. When you look at the story, you know they're made up, they can't be real, they can't be literal. But then I'm saying, I suggested the Hindus are claiming, look at my language, they're claiming that the Ramayana and Mahabharata have historic foundation. Remember the word is foundation. That actually happened. Why do I feel that it is true? How can I be sure? I can't be sure. See, if there's a youngster saying, I don't think it actually happened, I say, you can think for yourself. We will not impose it on you. Yes, you have to believe others, I'll hit you, thapat. We don't do that. We say, think for yourself. The reason why I personally think they are real is this. The story of Ram, you know, just Sita just mentioned, this was not an ordinary person, he was an extraordinary person. All the kings wanted to get bigger and bigger kingdom and money and women and all that. Here is Ram said, I give up my kingdom and go into the forest because for a principle. That's not normal. No other king did it before him. So he said, this is not an ordinary person. It can't be just made up story. Some great personality lived in ancient India who was so dynamic that for thousands of years, not only just India, the story of Ramayana went into Sri Lanka, then it went to Thailand and Burma and Malaysia, Indonesia. They all still sing the glories of Ram there in Bali and everywhere. So this can't be just made up. It can't travel that far. The reason why it has traveled that far and stood the test of time makes me feel, look, my language is very guarded. There was a personality, a great personality in ancient times called Ram. So the story of Ramayana has got historic foundation. So I think for myself and then I come to a decision. Same with the story of Krishna. You see, Krishna, there will be a lot of colorful stories and magic and all this stuff they add on. But the story of Krishna is a great personality who asked human beings to stop looking for God in heaven and help themselves. Think for themselves. This is what Krishna is all about. So I said, this can't happen by just legendary story. There must have been a great personality who has influenced India for thousands of years. Millions of people love this guy. So it can't be just make-believe. There must be a genuine personality. So that's the reason why Ramayana and Mahabharata are considered to be historic stories. In the Sanskrit word we use, itihas. They are itihas, they say, not Puran. Puran means legendary. Itihas means historic. Very good question. But again, do you see the openness of Hindu religion? Suppose you say, I don't believe it. Good for you, don't believe. Maybe legendary, but it's a very colorful story. So be it. Always be open-minded. Always think for yourself and come to a conclusion. Don't listen to me. I'm telling you why I think it's true. But you say, maybe I don't agree with that. But you're allowed to do that. In this religion, you're allowed. In other religion, if you do that, they'll kill you. In this religion, we don't even do thapat. We say, okay, carry on.
How did scriptures come to existence?
Okay, what is the source of scriptures? Very interesting thing. Where do the scriptures come from? Of course, we have talked about the Shruti scripture, the scripture of authority. How did they come? Did they fall out of the sky? We're walking in the forest in India, boom, they hit us on the head. This is the Vedas. How did the scriptures come about? Very important question. Where do they come from? Interesting thing is this. We say those individuals, those people who are able to experience God or spirit, Atman, I am that. Actually, there are people like that. The latest one that I can recommend is Ramana Maharshi. In South India until 1950. They said, we know what you're talking about, Atman, I am the spirit, I'm not the body. And when they want to do operation on his arm, on his shoulder, we should give you anesthetic. What anesthetic? I am not the body, I'm the spirit. Just cut. It was like that. You saw people like that, yes. These are really experienced people, people experience religion. So where do the Shrutis come from? The scripture of authority, they come from these people. When they experience God and spirit, etc., they become very vibrant. They're called rishis. They become very vibrant and then they give expression to their experience. What the experience, how this Atman experience is, or how does God look, what is the experience of God? They talk about it and then it becomes Shruti. The Shrutis come from enlightened people in the Hindu tradition who say God is a matter of experience for not just book learning. They're just copying the same old book. They say we experience God and now we'll tell you about it. And when they open their mouth, that's called the Vedas. This is the definition of Vedas, the Shrutis, scripture of authority. People who experience, tell us about their experience, is called the Vedas. This is the power of, this is where the Shrutis come from, the scripture of authority come from.
Why did God create us and nothing else? Why is it just us that our chance, like what is the chance of us? Like why is it just us? Why can we not go further in the world?
You see, he's asking why did God create? Now my answer is equally good. Ask God, leave me out. Actually, this is just, I'm just giving a gentle answer. The real answer is very difficult. what he's asked the most difficult question. Why does Brahman, the spirit that underpins the world, manifest itself with the creation and living things and human beings and evolve and get whacked in the process and kill each other? What's going on? Why, oh why? It's a very powerful question. And the answer that comes out of Hindu tradition is very powerful as well. He says, we have no idea. Really, no idea. There's no, I can't give a reason, so this is why he created, so you can love him. We don't talk nonsense. He says, rubbish. Why go through this process, so painful process of creation, evolution? Why, oh why? The Hindus say, as I said, nicely ask God, but the real answer is, there is no answer the Hindus are given which satisfies. There is none. I've studied Hinduism all my life, nothing. This is the honesty of this religion. We don't know why we are here, what the heck is going on. We are trying to sort ourselves out. That's called dharma.
So the hereditary system, if we find it bad, then what made people of the pre-hereditary system age, what influenced them for it to come about?
You see, these are lovely questions. So we say hereditary caste system is no longer relevant, if we've given it up a long time ago, then how did it start? Why did it start? This young boy is asking a very pointed question. This is the reason why it happened. You see, look, suppose you've got a family where your father and mother are both doctors. They would like you to be a doctor, so be a doctor, be a doctor. Why? Because they can help you. They're already in the field, they can guide you. So this is how it became hereditary. It is natural for parents to make sure that their children follow in their footsteps because they can help them. So if you're a potter in the village and you know how to make pots, you want your son or daughter to learn to make pots. That's natural, that's your skill you want to pass on to the next of your kin, next generation. This is how it became incorporated in the ancient ideas. It was easy for the parents to pass on their skills to the next generation, so that is how it became hereditary. But it is not necessarily good. Because look, we know, suppose you're a king and you've got a son, he's an idiot. But it's your son, he's going to become a king and you can't stop him. I shouldn't say that, Prince Charles, on the borderline. So this is the world that we live in. That's why he's not been made a king. So the thing is, just because it's hereditary, doesn't every time work out well. So we have to kind of reform our system of thinking. So I'll give you my personal example. I love physics and maths. Hello. So I was telling my daughter Sita, learn physics and maths. She said, no, Dad, go away. I couldn't make it hereditary. I was trying very hard. The only hereditary part that she follows is teaching Hinduism. I'll teach Hinduism as well. That's the only part we carry on. See, this is how it becomes hereditary.
With the gods, I've seen that most of the gods are Hindu gods. They're built on principles. So Shiva, he's the destroyer god. It's the principle of destroying. Vishnu, the preserver god, is about preserving the whole nation and everything. But then if we created gods, then it's just for symbolism, right? Then why create them in the first place? Why can't we just say the whole principle in the first place, worship the principle instead of the god?
First of all, let me tidy up, because people who are devotee of Shiva don't like this definition. This definition of Shiva comes from the Vaishnava tradition, saying that God as creator is called Brahma, God as preserver is called Vishnu, and God as destroyer is Shiva. Poor Shiva, so why should I be the destroyer? Now if you look at the Shiva tradition, the image of Shiva that I like is the image of Nataraj. You may have seen it in some temples. Shiva like that, with four arms, and kind of there's a circle around it. And this is the image of Shiva as Nataraj. Nataraj means king of the lord of the dance. So it's not just the Christians, we have lord of the dance, Shiva. Now the beautiful thing, the image in a way shows, in one hand he's got Damaru, little drum. The drum is the sound of creation. Where there's vibration starts, creation comes. It comes nicely with the modern science. In just vibration, drum. In the other hand, Shiva is holding a fire. Say, sign of destruction. Everything come up and go up in flames. With the third hand, he's offering boons. Don't be frightened. With the fourth hand, this is a preserver, I'll preserve you. With the fourth hand, he's pointing at his own foot. You know what he says? Come under my shelter, I will reveal to you what is the nature of Shiva. So with this image of Shiva, you see he's a creator, preserver and destroyer all the same time. So the Shiva devotees prefer that. So you can't just call him destroyer. In fact, the cycle of creation and destruction is called the dance of Shiva. See that? This is like the... So you must be very careful. Don't kind of undermine Shiva tradition saying it's purely destroyer. It's not true.